Not a problem.
Welcome, everyone. It's great to be together again, kick off the 2021-22 Forster Lecture Series. To begin this evening, I'd like to invite our Dean, Dr. Luke Fetters, to come up and open us with prayer.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege to gather, to learn, to expand our understanding of your word and our world, and to see you as Lord of all. We thank you for the experiences, the relationships, and the disciplines of a lifetime that have guided Dr. Beck's path to intersect with ours this evening. Bless us as we attend together this evening, to Dr. Beck, to each other, and to your spirit within us. Guide our thoughts, we pray. Amen.
We were fortunate enough to get Professor Randy Beck to speak for us tonight because Professor Becky Benjamin knows him from a time when they overlapped at University of Georgia. That makes her the most qualified person to introduce him, and she has kindly agreed to do so. Dr. Benjamin?
Thank you, Dr. Drury. Randy Beck has been with the University of Georgia School of Law since 1997 on the faculty. He was named Associate Dean for Academic Affairs in 2018 and has just relinquished those responsibilities and is back to teaching more. He's held the Justice Thomas O. Marshall Chair of Constitutional Law since 2011. And was the 2016-2017 Garwood Visiting Fellow in Princeton University's James Madison Program in American Ideals and Institutions. Beck's constitutional law scholarship has appeared in a number of law reviews, including the Notre Dame Law Review, the American Journal of Legal History, and the Northwestern University Law Review. His law and religion scholarship includes the chapter, The Biblical Foundations of Law, Creation, Fall, and the Patriarchs, in the InterVarsity Press title, Law and the Bible, Justice, Mercy, and Legal Institutions. He's also written God the Judge and Human Justice in the Journal of Law and Religion, published by Cambridge University Press. Prior to his law school appointment, Dr. Beck worked as a general litigation associate with the Perkins Coie Law Firm in Seattle and as an attorney advisor in the United States Department of Justice Office of Legal Counsel. He served as a judicial clerk for the U.S. Supreme Court, Justice Anthony Kennedy, and Judge Patrick Higginbotham of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Fifth Circuit. He graduated from Southern Methodist University School of Law and earned his undergraduate degree from Baker University. But I think the most amazing thing about Randy Beck and his wife Beth, who have been friends of ours since basically the 14 years that Nate and I have been married, they were our first friends when we moved to Georgia, having us out for lunch when we visited their church. It's his humility, hospitality that is unending, and just in general, kindness. So in addition to being a stellar teacher of students and communicator and thinker, especially of the integration with law and the Christian faith, he is a person to emulate. So I'd like to welcome Randy.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here in Indiana and to be able to speak with you today. Had a great day, got to attend a couple of classes, meet some students at meals, and it's just been a wonderful opportunity. My wife and I have long been friends with Professor Benjamin and her husband Nate, so the trip was a good chance to reconnect with them and meet some of the children that we hadn't had a chance to meet yet. I was particularly excited by this invitation when I found out that Huntington University is associated with the Church of the United Brethren in Christ. I married into a family that had roots in the Evangelical United Brethren denomination, a denomination that came from the same roots as the United Brethren, but then eventually merged into the United Methodists. My wife's grandparents were EUB missionaries in Sierra Leone. That's where her mother was born. We gave our daughter the middle name Leone to kind of commemorate that part of our heritage. So I feel like I have a chance to speak with some of my wife's theological cousins. I want to talk today about the intersection of Christian faith and politics. We recently came through an election year. So how does God want our relationship with Him to shape our participation in politics? What are the implications of Christian faith for the political sphere? Should we be involved in human politics at all? Or is that too worldly for people who say God is our king? Assuming Christians should be involved in politics, what are our goals? How should our beliefs impact the way we vote or the way we engage in political discussions? My goal is not to convince you to support a particular candidate or party or platform. I want to approach this topic through a biblical lens, and I want to start with a passage where Jesus engages a very controversial topic in a politically polarized culture. I thought that would be a helpful starting place because we live in a time where our own political culture is becoming very polarized. There seems to be increasing distance among our political factions and higher levels of animosity towards those who think and vote differently. So that's not really something new. We'll see that Jesus also ministered in a politically polarized culture. After we examine how Jesus answered a divisive political topic in his day, I then want to step back and briefly offer a biblical framework for thinking about faith and politics. The premise is that the Babylonian captivity provides a useful theological lens through which we can think about faith and politics. It's a biblical framework that I think leaves room for Christians to adopt a range of different political views on particular issues or parties or candidates. But we're going to start by focusing on the account in Matthew's gospel of Jesus addressing the question of whether you should pay taxes to Caesar. Dr. Fetter's already prayed, but I'm going to be speaking. So if you don't mind, I'd like to pray briefly and then dive into it. So, Lord, we hear from your word that whether we eat or drink or whatever we do, we're to do it all for your glory. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us tonight to understand your word and that it would help to shape the way that we participate in politics so that that can bring glory to you as well. Pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so our passage is from Matthew 22, a famous passage. Let's just start by reading it. It says, "Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle him in his words. And they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, 'Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?' But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, 'Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax.' And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, 'Whose likeness and inscription is this?' They said, 'Caesar's.' And he said to them, 'Therefore, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's.' When they heard it, they marveled, and they left him and went away." So we're told that the Pharisees are setting a trap for Jesus. They want to entangle him in what he says. And so let's think about the ways that Jesus' words could trip him up so that we can see how he avoids the danger. Notice that the trap involves asking a question about law. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? If you want to trap somebody, if you want to get somebody in trouble, law can be a useful tool, can't it? Laws imposed by some government or authority that has power. The authority can compel obedience or punish disobedience. There are typically sanctions imposed if you violate the law. When a person gets on the wrong side of a legal question, the authority enforcing the law may bring coercion or punishment to bear. So when it says Jesus perceived the Pharisees' malice, he recognized that the people asking him the question were hoping he would get punished, right? They wanted bad things to happen to him, right? And that's why they ask a question about law, right? Now, what law are they asking about, right? So the question in verse 17 is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not, right? So is this a question about Roman law? Well, the question wouldn't make much sense if they were asking about Roman law, right? Roman law is where the obligation to pay tax comes from. That's the law that tells you you must pay taxes. And so it's obviously lawful under Roman law to pay taxes to Caesar. So what law are they asking about? Well, they're asking Jesus a question about the law of God given through Moses, a law that mattered a great deal to the Jewish people, but that meant nothing to the Roman authorities. And so notice that the question tossed out in front of Jesus is really a question about the relationship between two different bodies of law. Roman law requires people to pay taxes to Caesar. The question is whether that is consistent with the law of God given through Moses. When you have two sets of law in play, that increases the potential danger. Right? Now Jesus has to worry about two laws enforced by two different authorities and how they relate to each other. Right? Now, notice verse 16. It says that they sent their disciples, the Pharisees sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. So there are two different groups that are coming to question Jesus and to be part of this crowd in front of him. Why would the Pharisees bring Herodians with them when they're going to ask this question? To understand the trap that's being set for Jesus, I think it helps to recognize that the crowd questioning Jesus includes members of two very different social or political factions that have different commitments, and who might reach very different conclusions about the question of paying taxes to Caesar. The Herodians are supporters of a regime that was installed and backed by Rome. They're committed to the authority of Caesar as king, and they want people to obey Roman law. For them, the question of whether to pay taxes to Caesar is obvious. The Romans are in charge, we do what the Romans say. Right? The Pharisees, on the other hand, have a different set of commitments. They would say God is their real king, not Caesar. The law that really matters, in their view, is the law of God mediated through Moses. And for them, the issue of paying taxes to Caesar doesn't necessarily have a clear answer. It's at least an open question. And some Pharisees take the view that God's law means you shouldn't pay taxes to Caesar. So, this allows us to flesh out the setting for the Pharisees' trap. The legal issue brought to Jesus is potentially risky because it concerns the relationship between two distinct authorities or kings, demanding compliance with two distinct sets of laws, and with the political support of two polarized political factions. The Pharisees have brought this legal conflict to Jesus in a very public environment, and they've set it up so that the crowd includes partisans on both sides of the question that he is being asked about. So what are the Pharisees hoping Jesus will say? How do they envision this playing out? Well, in Luke's gospel, his account of this passage, of this encounter, there's this verse. So they watched him and sent spies who pretended to be sincere that they might catch him in something he said, so as to deliver him up to the authority and jurisdiction of the governor. The Pharisees apparently expect Jesus to say that it is unlawful to pay taxes to Caesar. That will then give them a reason to report him to the Roman governor, who will then arrest him and neutralize the threat he posed to their authority. So that kind of creates a puzzle, or at least mystery for us, right? Why would they expect Jesus to say, you can't pay taxes to Caesar? Why is that the expectation from the Pharisees? What's the case for arguing that God's law makes it unlawful to pay Roman taxes? To understand what's going on, I think it helps to be familiar with some history that would have been well known in Jesus' day. There was a Jewish historian who wrote shortly after Jesus' time, whose name was Josephus. And let's look at a couple of passages from his writing that tell something about the history of the Jewish people, including some things that are relevant here. So the top passage from his book, Antiquities of the Jews, talks about four sects of Jewish philosophy, right? So he says there are Pharisees, there are Sadducees, there are Essenes, and then the fourth sect are what we call the Zealots. And here's what he says. He says, but of the fourth sect of Jewish philosophy, the Zealots, Judas the Galilean was the author. These men agree in all other things with the Pharisaic notions, but they have an inviolable attachment to liberty, and they say that God is to be their only ruler and Lord. Right? And then earlier in the same book, he gives some more history about Judas and the Zealots. He says, Judas, taking with him Sadduc, a Pharisee, became zealous to draw them to a revolt, who both said that this taxation was no better than an introduction to slavery, and exhorted the nation to assert their liberty. He says, all sorts of misfortunes also sprang from these men, and the nation was infected with this doctrine to an incredible degree. One violent war came upon us after another. Right? So fairly recent history, there had been lots of Jewish people killed as a result of this zealot kind of position that you should not pay taxes to Caesar. And they rested their position on a very strong view of God-given liberty. God is our king, not Caesar. Notice that their claim is that paying taxes to Caesar is effectively a form of slavery. That's a claim that would have had a special resonance for a Jewish audience. Remember, their national history was centered on the recognition that God had delivered his people from slavery in Egypt. The Promised Land was supposed to be originally the place where they were free from the demands of a pagan king, and the place where you could have a land of your own and serve God freely without some foreign king interfering. So submitting to Caesar, in their view, is almost like letting Pharaoh govern in the Promised Land, right? God is our king, not Caesar. Judas, the Galilean, who it comes up in Josephus, is actually mentioned in the Bible. In the book of Acts, Gamaliel, who was teacher to the Apostle Paul when he was a Pharisee, stands up and gives a speech to the Sanhedrin talking about what should we do about these followers of Jesus who are stirring up all of this contention in the city. And he recounts some recent history of other people who kind of had a following, and then it had all kind of dissipated and hadn't been a problem in the long run, right? And so he mentions Theudas, and then he says, after Theudas, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. It's interesting to think about the fact that they staged their uprising at the time of the census. Why would that be? Well, the reason the Roman government had the census was as a prelude to collecting taxes, right? And so when they start counting people so they know who to tax, that's when the zealots say, we need to stand up for our liberty and not be counted, right? It's kind of interesting to think about what insight that gives us into Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus. At the time when Judas of Galilee is stirring up people to resist the Roman tax collectors, what does Joseph do? He responds very differently, right? When the decree goes out from Caesar Augustus, Joseph packs up his pregnant fiancée Mary, he leaves Galilee, he makes a long and difficult journey to Bethlehem, his family's ancestral home, so that he can be counted there as a prelude to paying the Roman tax. Interestingly, it's Joseph's submission to the Roman authorities, his unwillingness to throw his lot in with the zealots, that results in the Messiah being born in Bethlehem, according to the prophecy. Now, back to Jesus and the question about paying taxes to Rome. We have this recent history of Judas the Galilean leading the Zealot movement and convincing many people that they should fight the Roman occupation rather than pay taxes to Caesar. But why would the Pharisees assume that Jesus is going to side with the Zealots? Why do they think he's going to say you cannot pay taxes to Caesar? I think it's because to the Pharisees, Jesus in some ways sounded and acted like a zealot, right? They looked at him and they said, he reminds us a lot of these zealots, right? So think about some of these points. One, Jesus came from Galilee, which was where Judas the Galilean had come from, kind of the hotbed of the zealot movement, right? He preached about the kingdom of God, and he advocated an uncompromising obedience to God as king. That's comparable in some ways to the zealot teaching, that God is your only ruler and Lord, right? He's the one you should submit to. Jesus named a zealot, Simon the Zealot, to be one of his 12 original apostles. And then just days before this encounter in the temple, Jesus enters Jerusalem on a donkey, kind of essentially reenacting the coronation of King Solomon. And the crowd celebrate the son of David, the king of Israel. They cry, blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. That sounds kind of like the crowd is calling for regime change, right? And remember, Jesus refuses to rebuke them when they do that, right? And so there's one element of the Pharisees' trap. They suspect that since Jesus is committed to God's rule as king, he's another Galilean zealot. And he's not going to allow them to pay taxes to a pagan king like Caesar. If they can get him to acknowledge that publicly, then they can get him arrested. The Roman government will take care of the problem for them, right? But what if Jesus surprises the Pharisees? You know, what if he says it's okay to pay taxes to Caesar? You know, is that the point at which the villains kind of walk away muttering curses foiled again, you know? Ultimately, I think the trap did not depend necessarily on Jesus taking the position they expected. Look at this passage from Matthew's gospel. It says, when the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they held him to be a prophet. So the reason the temple leaders had not arrested Jesus on their own authority was his popularity with the people of the crowd. If Jesus, though, took a position in favor of paying taxes to Rome, that could alienate some of his supporters. If Jesus advocates paying taxes to Caesar, some people who are really excited to think he was setting up a new kingdom are going to conclude he's selling out, right? If Jesus loses the protection afforded by his popularity, the temple leaders then can take care of the problem on their own without Roman help. If you go back to our passage, I think this helps explain verse 16. When the Pharisees and Herodians come and question Jesus, notice what they say. Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. I think that sort of fawning praise is really part of the trap, right? The Pharisees are trying to goad Jesus into opposing payment of taxes to Rome with a subtle suggestion that you need to stick to your principles and not bend to suit powerful people. But if Jesus supports paying taxes to the Romans, then this helps underscore the impression that he's caving into pressure, that he has, he's worried about the Roman authorities, and so he's going to acknowledge Caesar as Lord just to stay safe. Right? Remember that this is an occupied country. Israel is under the dominion of a foreign government. There are different kinds of people who respond to that in different ways. There are some people who think you should cooperate with the Roman authorities. There are others who think you should resist. And both kinds of people are in the crowd. And so no matter what Jesus says, he's going to alienate somebody. Right? Now, let's think about how Jesus sidesteps the trap. He asks those questioning him to produce the coin used to pay the tax. And he asks whose image and inscription are on the coin. When they acknowledge that the image and the inscription are those of Caesar, Jesus offers the principle, well, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. So what is he saying about the coin? He speaks kind of cryptically, doesn't he? You almost need to unpack it a little bit, right? But let's see if we can figure out what the argument is. Why is it okay to pay the coin to Caesar in the form of taxes? Well, he highlights the fact that Jesus created the coin and that it is stamped with Caesar's image. It belongs to Caesar, it was his originally, and therefore he can ask for it back in the form of taxes. But Jesus here is speaking about both kings. His comments relate to what Caesar can rightfully ask, but they also relate to what God can rightfully ask. So if the coin belongs to Caesar because Caesar made it and it bears his image, then what are the things that belong to God? Right? Presumably, if we should give Caesar things that he made that bear his image, we should give God whatever he made that bears his image. Right? Well, what bears the image of God? Scripture is very clear on that from the very beginning, that we humans all bear the image of God. We are made in his image. We bear his likeness. And so Caesar can ask for the coins back because they are stamped with his image, but God can ask for our entire lives because we are made by him in his image, right? And so the Pharisees' trap rested on an assumed dichotomy. For the zealots and for many in Jesus' audience, there are two kings, and it's a simple question of, which king are you going to obey? Which one has priority? If you pay taxes to Caesar, you're setting the authority of Caesar over that of God. To acknowledge God's authority, you have to reject Roman taxation. But Jesus rejects that simple dichotomy, and he gives us a different and more nuanced picture of the relationship between God's authority and Caesar's authority. As Jesus envisions it, Caesar's authority is a limited subset of the authority of God. Caesar has authority over things like currency and taxes, but God has authority over all of human life. Right? As Jesus says to the Roman governor Pilate in John's gospel, you would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. So, can meditating on this passage about Jesus in the temple help us in the 21st century? In some ways, I think we face a situation similar or analogous to the one that Jesus faced. He lived in a very polarized political culture. There were political factions that disagreed with each other strongly. Some of the disagreements were grounded in theological differences. Others had ethnic and historical roots. The divisions were so deep that they sometimes resulted in violence. The question of paying taxes to Caesar, in particular, was a question that had gotten both Jews and Romans killed. In that setting, Jesus' adversaries challenged him to answer a very divisive political question in a very public setting in front of a crowd filled with partisans from different factions. And so what lessons might we learn from the way Jesus responds to that jeopardy that they placed him in? Right? Here are a few things that I thought might be worth highlighting. First of all, Jesus spoke the truth. The things Jesus said were only things that he believed were true. And his view of the truth was shaped by his theology, not by the agenda of some political faction. Some of the things Jesus said lined up with the positions of the zealots. Some of the things he said lined up with the positions of the Herodians. One way we go astray in politics, I think, is through what is sometimes referred to as tribalism. We sign on to become members of political team A or political team B. And then from that point on, our partisan affiliation exerts this gravitational pull that distorts our values and our perception of reality, right? We start to affirm doubtful things because they line up with our party's agenda, and we deny things that are obviously true because we're afraid it might help the other side. Secondly, notice that Jesus shared some theological views with the zealots, but he differed on political implications of those theological views, right? It seems significant that he distances himself from the political agenda of the zealots, even though there were a lot of theological affirmations that they shared in common, right? Yes, God is king. You're right. Yes, God's authority is greater than Caesar's authority. No, that doesn't mean it's wrong to pay taxes to Caesar. So just because we find somebody who has good theology and we think they've got a handle on that, it doesn't necessarily mean that we have to follow them when they say, well, that has political implications X, Y, or Z. Those are distinct questions. Third, notice that while Jesus affirmed things that are true, he chose his words carefully. In this highly charged public setting, he avoided blunt and inflammatory formulations that would have given people a reason to pick up rocks and start stoning him, right? He never gave the Pharisees the soundbite that they were looking for. Right? He offers an abstract principle that almost sounds like a word puzzle or an epigram, right? You got to think through it before you even know what he's saying, right? What is the conclusion? Can we or can't we? You know, let me think about this. But once you've thought through it, then you realize, no, he's actually not saying that Caesar is more important than God, is he, right? And so he does not kind of give stark, blunt answers to questions that will inflame the crowd. He gives truthful answers, but ones that require some thought before you can tease out the implications. Fourth, Jesus highlights the Pharisees' hypocrisy. There's a lot of acting that goes on in politics. It's not uncommon for politicians to say things they don't really believe because they think it might secure some short-term advantage. In this case, the Pharisees' hypocrisy was malicious. And Jesus calls them out for it. He says, "Why are you testing me, you hypocrites?" Hypocrite, as I understand it, comes from a Greek word for actor, right? So he's accusing them of acting. They're playing a role rather than speaking sincerely about something that they really believe. He reinforces that point later on by asking his interlocutors to show him the coin used to pay the tax. The fact that they have the coin with them, bearing Caesar's image, shows that the people questioning him are willing participants in Caesar's economy. They posture themselves as so devoted to the law of God that they'll resist Roman occupation if that's what God's law requires, but in reality, they're happily accepting the benefits of Caesar's rule while simultaneously raising questions about Caesar's authority. Now, let me make one last point about the tax controversy before we broaden out the discussion a little bit. Take a look at Matthew's list of the 12 disciples that Jesus called. Right? We already mentioned that one of them is Simon the Zealot, one of the 12. But notice that another of the disciples was Matthew the tax collector. Isn't that interesting? Right? That Jesus called both a zealot and a tax collector for the Romans to be among his closest disciples. It's hard to imagine two people further apart in terms of political beliefs. Right? It's a testimony to the appeal of Jesus that two such radically different people are both drawn to him. And it's a testimony, I think, to the inclusiveness of the gospel that Christ welcomes both of them into his inner circle. He wants both of them to be among the 12 closest disciples. I like to think that when Jesus sent out his disciples two by two for ministry, that he made Matthew and Simon go together. Right? Imagine those conversations on the road. Right? Yeah. Now, let's step back from our passage and think more broadly about political theology through a biblical lens. One theme you find throughout the New Testament is that Christians are part of a distinct political community. We're described as citizens of a heavenly city built by God, the New Jerusalem, the Jerusalem above, right? And so Paul in Philippians says our citizenship is in heaven. The author of Hebrews says you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, right? And so we, as Christians, have a new citizenship. We are citizens of the new Jerusalem, this history, this city that God is building that will be revealed at the end of history, right? As a corollary, when we live our lives in this world, we are not in our political home. Rather, we live as aliens and strangers in this world, right? And so Peter, in his first epistle, says, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile. He says, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh. Or again from Hebrews, here we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come, right? And so Christians are portrayed as subjects of God's kingdom, citizens of this heavenly New Jerusalem, living as aliens and strangers among the cities of this world, right? Jesus in our passage from Matthew had to wrestle with the relationship between Roman law and God's law. As citizens of the New Jerusalem, we experience a similar tension. We're subject to the law of God, but we're also subject to the jurisdiction of some earthly government that makes laws of its own. And so to me, the best biblical picture of the church's situation is found in the Old Testament books of the Babylonian captivity. That's the period when Israel's history was interrupted by King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. He sends his armies to Jerusalem. He destroys the city. He takes many of God's people captive into Babylon, or some end up in Susa in the Persian Empire, etc. During that captivity, God's people are citizens of Jerusalem who live in exile. They are anticipating this future point when their permanent home, the New Jerusalem, will be available again, the exile can end, they can go to where they are really from. But in the meantime, they live as exiles among neighbors who worship other gods, right? So they live in Babylon for this period of their existence. If that's a good picture of the church's situation, if that's a good analogy, then I think books like Daniel and Esther and Nehemiah are great books for us to study because they show God's people playing constructive roles in the political life of earthly cities like Babylon, Susa, etc. Those who have looked to the Babylonian captivity as a model for political theology have often reflected on Jeremiah 29. In this chapter, God sends instructions through the prophet Jeremiah to his people living in exile in Babylon. Here's what you do while you're there, right? So he says, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all the exiles whom I have sent into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce, take wives and have sons and daughters. Take wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage that they may bear sons and daughters. Multiply there and do not decrease. But seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare." So the basic message is you're not in Jerusalem at this point. You're in Babylon. Babylon's not your ultimate home. It's not your final destination, but you're going to be here for a while. So while you're here, settle down, build families, provide for them, seek to make Babylon a better place, right? The word translated welfare in this translation is a version of the Hebrew word shalom. It's often translated peace, but the word suggests more than just the absence of conflict. It's a fuller idea. It's in the name of the city of Jerusalem, right? The Salem at the end of Jerusalem is a version of this word shalom, right? And so when the psalmist says to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, there's kind of a play on words in the original language, right? Pray for the shalom of Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of the city of peace, right? But God is now telling his people who live in exile, now pray for Babylon and seek the peace of Babylon, because that's where you're living right now. And so try to seek out and promote the welfare, the shalom of Babylon, where God has you living at the moment. Right? One of the people who reflected on the Babylonian captivity as a basis for political theology was St. Augustine, an influential bishop of the church at the turn of the 5th century, in a classic work, The City of God. It's too long, don't read the whole thing, but find a good set of excerpts and read it. In reflecting on Jeremiah 29, Augustine draws a distinction between two kinds of peace. You know, for Christians, he says, citizens of the city of God, their ultimate end is eternal peace, peace with God through all ages in the heavenly city. This is the greatest good that humans can experience. That is what we really are longing for and will experience one day. Babylon, he says, is never going to have that kind of peace, right? You're never going to have the perfect eternal peace of the heavenly city while you're in Babylon. But at the same time, there is a kind of a lesser form of peace. There's kind of an earthly or temporal version of peace that is a good thing to the extent it can be accomplished. And so seek the peace, seek the welfare, seek the shalom of Babylon. It will never be the heavenly city, but make it as close as you can get it while you're here, right? So if we think of ourselves as part of a present-day Babylon, a part of a present-day Babylonian captivity, if we're citizens of the New Jerusalem who are living as aliens and strangers in the cities of this world, what implications does that have for the way that we engage in politics? I actually think there's room for Christians in good faith to reach different conclusions about many political positions as they seek the shalom of the United States or of Indiana or of Georgia, right? I don't necessarily want to advocate particular positions and say all Christians have to support policy X or candidate Y or party Z. But let me offer a couple of big picture thoughts that I think are useful in reflecting on this idea of seeking the shalom of Babylon. First, as we participate in the political process, we need to avoid falling into idolatry. That is a theme highlighted more than once in the Psalms. So here's a passage from Psalm 146. Do not put your trust in princes, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. No matter how we engage in political activities, we are not going to create the New Jerusalem on earth. Every policy decision is going to involve trade-offs. Every political position that seems to have some advantages will inevitably carry with it some unintended disadvantages, many of which we may not even anticipate. Politics matter, but they are not of ultimate importance. The government cannot save anyone. If every person I support was elected to office and every law that I support was enacted, no person would receive eternal life or forgiveness of sins as a result. So don't let earthly politics or any political figure or party or platform become an idol. Don't let political power take the place of God in your thinking. Don't make a political agenda your ground for hope for the future. The real hope is that God is creating a city for us, the New Jerusalem. Right? Second, as we participate in earthly politics, the way we go about it may be as important as the political goals we pursue. I often hear people in politics, including Christians, saying what we really need in government is a fighter, right? Somebody who's going to battle for our positions. If the mission God has given us is to seek the peace of the city where we dwell, should we really be that eager to get into fights, right? Should we be the ones kind of provoking animosity? Remember that God told his people to pray for Babylon and to seek her peace shortly after the Babylonian armies had destroyed the city of Jerusalem, had killed many of God's people, had carried others into captivity, right? And at that point, God says, okay, I want you to pray for Babylon. I want you to seek her peace. That's a hard thing to ask. But let me suggest that there are lots of familiar biblical principles concerning relationships that still apply when we are involved in discussions or deliberations around politics, right? So, for instance, from the Sermon on the Mount, in everything, therefore, treat the people the same way you want them to treat you, for that is the law and the prophets. Right? If possible, from Romans, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Again, from the Sermon on the Mount, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven. Or from the Proverbs, a soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. As you look around cable news or social media, how many people engaging in political discussions are treating other people the way they would like to be treated themselves? How many of them are showing love to their political adversaries? How many are responding to anger with a gentle answer that diffuses the conflict. Right? One effect of tribalism in politics, I think, is that we come to disrespect those with whom we disagree. We stop viewing them as neighbors to be loved, and we start thinking of them as enemies to be vanquished, as people who deserve our scorn and contempt. Right? There's an interesting passage in Augustine's City of God where he is suggesting that we should bear patiently with those we view as adversaries of the church, in part because some of them will be members of the church one day. Augustine says, Christians should remember that among our most declared enemies, there are now some unknown to themselves who are destined to become our friends. Consequently, we should patiently bear with what they inflict as enemies until they become confessors of the faith. So don't let your politics undermine your evangelism. Right? When you're engaged in a political discussion, you don't know which of the people you're speaking with might one day come to Christ. Treat everyone you interact with as someone who might end up as a brother or sister in the faith. So there's a lot more that we could say, and you may have questions that bring out more discussion, but let me wrap it up there and invite questions.
So Professor Beck has kindly agreed to field some questions from you. We would just ask if you think for a moment carefully and frame it concisely and try to have a sharp question to ask and let him address it. So,
what you were talking about, could it be used in, like, when you're handling an interview, per se, if someone is trying to ask you questions and make you to say something that you will regret not to say?
I think, yeah, those biblical principles about how you treat other people, they apply in lots of different contexts. I think the interview context is a great example. And especially, you know, it's kind of like the Pharisees, right? Somebody interviewing for your job, they may be trying to trap you, right? Get you to say the wrong thing. And so if you kind of are careful in that context and treat them kindly and gently, that can often get you through a difficult discussion. Yeah. So. Back.
Thank you again for your words. I really appreciated what you said. I'm wondering what counsel you can offer as it pertains to maybe loving a neighbor experiencing persecution within the world of activism.
Yeah. Yeah. I teach a course periodically at the law school called Christian Perspectives on Legal Thought. And so basically it is a survey of different Christian theological traditions and the ways they've thought about law and government. And it's been a great course, and we had lots of great discussions. And students write a paper at the end. And I remember one of the most thought-provoking papers I ever saw was, what do you do if you're a Christian in a country that persecutes Christianity, right? What do you do if you're part of the church in a part of the world where Christianity is illegal, where you might be jailed, where worse things might happen to you? And it was a great paper, and the student made me think about things I hadn't even really had to think about in my comfortable American context where we have freedom of religion, right? I think the one passage that comes to mind is Jesus telling his disciples that they're going to be persecuted. But he says at one point that, if you're persecuted in one city, flee to the next, right? And so one way to respond for those who can is remove yourself from the situation where the persecution takes place. Now that is great advice for people who are near a border, who have transportation out, but it doesn't work for lots of people in lots of parts of the world. And so I think, you know, that's a really difficult place to be. I suggested that the books of the Babylonian captivity are very helpful in dealing with our current situation. And I think one of the books that's very helpful is the book of Esther. And Esther actually, to some extent, addresses that situation that God's people are living in Susa, the capital of Persia, and there is at least a plan for persecution. And so if you remember, you know, the king has an advisor, Haman, who really dislikes the Jewish people and gets the king to issue a decree that, you know, they can be killed on one day that's been named. Anybody can kill them, plunder their goods, or whatever. And so I guess my first suggestion for somebody who is in a place of persecution that cannot get away, read and think about the book of Esther, because it kind of talks about a people, God's people, in a similar situation and the way that they were rescued from it. So that book has a happy ending for God's people. You know, God uses the queen, who is Jewish, to kind of intervene and protect them from the persecution. And so, you know, pray for help from places maybe even you're not expecting it. I guess the final thought, and this is a hard one, but that our ultimate hope is not in this life. Our ultimate hope is that God will resurrect his people, that they will enjoy an eternal home with him in the New Jerusalem, and that the people to whom that promise is given, you know, most kindly and gently in the New Testament are precisely those who are martyrs for the faith, right? Those who lose their lives because they are under an oppressive government that wants to shut them down.
Well, Tom mentioned something about activism, right? So I was thinking of the civil rights movement, like the Shalom there required kind of a little bit more confrontational action on the part of people who felt like, you know, justice needed to be obtained so that there could then be that, you know, peace that he's describing. So, you know, your kind of idea of withdrawing, get away from that situation seems contrary to this idea that in some cases, you know, courting persecution, courting violence from the oppressor is in the service of this kind of Shalom idea, right? So
yeah,
I just wanted to sort of point that out and get your reaction to that.
No, I think that's a great point. When we do my seminar on Christian perspectives on legal thought, we read Dr. King's letter from Birmingham Jail. We read some of Archbishop Tutu's writing from South Africa. And that's one of the reasons I suggested that the word Shalom is broader than simply the absence of conflict, right? It's not a message that you should avoid conflict at all costs, because there are other important things, including issues of justice. And so in many contexts, it may be that confronting misuse of authority is an appropriate response, a way of seeking the shalom of Babylon by pointing out that it needs to change, right? So I don't want to discount that at all. Now, whether you do that is a matter of wisdom that may differ from context to context, from country to country. There are places where you can lead nonviolent resistance, like in America. I think Bishop Tutu's involvement in the protests against apartheid helped that country change without the bloodshed that might have occurred, that you might have expected after a long period of oppression, right? And so seeking the Shalom of Babylon may affect not necessarily whether you take a position at all, but how you approach it, right? What is your methodology as you engage in political action? And I think, you know, Dr. King's nonviolent protest was an effort to seek the peace of Babylon while promoting its peace in the sense of greater justice. Yeah.
Any other questions for Professor Beck?
Yes. It seems to me I'm going to use the example of face masks have become something that's very politically charged. We go to a very large evangelical church, and even within this church, there's disagreement and factions and people saying don't wear a face mask, other people saying do, and I'm just using this as an example. There's other things too, but what are some examples that you would see, biblical examples of how something like that was handled or that Christ would handle that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not thinking of an immediate passage where Christ encountered something that I'd view as comparable to that. I do recognize that there's this general principle in Scripture that you should respect the authority of those who have authority, right? And so if somebody has been placed in a position of governmental responsibility, and they issue a decree that people should wear masks, then I think that Romans 13 principle of respecting authorities would be a good way to respond, instead of kind of resisting the authority on the ground that is interfering with your liberty. That sounds a little bit too much like the zealots to me, right? At the same time, human authority is not kind of limitless. And so you find places in Scripture where a human authority issues a decree and God's people feel like they have to resist because that is the only way they can obey God. And so when King Nebuchadnezzar tells his people, tells the Jewish people in Babylon, you must bow down to this idol, well, they have a law from God saying you may not bow down to idols, right? And so they have to resist that one, even though it comes from somebody who is in a position of authority. But I think those situations maybe don't come up as often as we fear they do, right? That we Christians have a habit of assuming that God has given us directions that he really hasn't, right? Or that, to obey God, I need to do X, when that's not really something God has told you to do. And so there may be more room for respect for authority, at least in our American evangelical context, than we currently recognize.
Can we do one more?
You bet.
Thank you, Randy.
Hey.
Not so much a question as a comment. You'd put up on the screen a coin, and it's important to note that there's two kinds of coins that were produced throughout the Mediterranean. There's the imperial coinage, which is produced by the emperor and the Senate, and that always bears the image of the emperor or the emperor's family or important dignitaries. But there's also provincial coinage, and the provincial coinage typically will depict a god or a governor or relations, important citizens of the localities. What's interesting is all the provincial coinage in Palestine does not bear the image of a god or an animal or a human being. And I think we all know the reason for that. One of the Ten Commandments is that you shall not make any graven image. And that pertained to the coins as well. So if you look at coins minted in Jerusalem, Galilee, and elsewhere, none of them have any kind of an image on them. Instead, they will have fruits, they'll have objects, they will have writing, inscriptions, things of that sort. Yeah. Now, what's interesting about that is who made the rule? It was the Pharisees. The Pharisees were the most legalistic upholders of the Torah, and that's how they applied the Torah to everyday life in a very stringent manner. So it's interesting that when Jesus asks the Pharisees to pull a coin out of their pocket, it's hypocrisy. They themselves have a coin in their pocket that bears the image of Caesar rather than provincial coinage. And so I think that's one of the reasons why the Pharisees quickly retreated with Jesus' response, is because he's embarrassing them, exposing them for the frauds that they were.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Fairchild. I will not even pretend that I'm anywhere near you in ability to talk about the New Testament or the history, and I'm very grateful for that comment. Thank you.
Let's thank Professor Beck for once again.